In 1963, the choreographer Elio Pomare is living in Germany. Like so many African-American artists before him, he left the United States seeking a more hospitable climate for his work. After 2 years of performing throughout the continent, he is becoming more and more alienated from Europe. Back at home, civil rights organizers are preparing for a massive march on Washington, expected to draw 250,000 demonstrators. As the event approaches, Pomare gets a call from a friend, the writer James Baldwin.
Jimmy, he called me several days before the march on Washington. He said, Elio, you are going to be there, and you better come home. That march literally changed the rest of what I would do, what I would say, and where I belonged. Freedom, freedom, freedom. Up until today, you know, if any shit is gonna fly, I want it to be here when it happens.
Inspired by the fervor around him, Pomare decides to stay in New York and develop his choreography. There, he is struck by the harsh reality of inner-city life for African-Americans and vows to confront it in his dances.
Politically, in America, so much was happening, and it affected what happened on stage. The issue of black identity. I mean, the issue of saying, okay, if I'm black, that means, what does that mean in terms of the kind of art that I create? What does that mean in terms of the kind of dance that I do?
In 1966, Pomare jolts the dance scene with Blues for the Jungle. The work depicts a cast of characters drawn from the black community, previously unseen on the concert stage.
He brings in not only the themes of the new militants, but some of the socially aberrant behaviors that had started to invade our community, like drug addiction. He imparts a new validity to black life in much the same way that Malcolm X does.
I was very conscious of not wanting to appeal to an audience who was there just to see the beauty of the Negro. And what a choreographer should do is to instigate or to be forecasters of things to come.
The artists coming out of this era began to reflect this larger sense of the social revolution that was going on in America at that point. And therefore, the black artists emerging during that era actually reflected this sense of experimentation.
But not all the experimentation in the dance world is dealing with social issues. In Greenwich Village, young artists in workshops are re-exploring the possibilities of movement.
Simone Forti was presenting a dance to us, and she was singing an Italian aria, and at the same time had a garden hose going full force into her face so that the sound and the water were meeting. And I found it so wonderful, but I didn't know why. I had never seen anything like this before.
These explorations capture the imagination of Gus Solomons Jr., a dancer from Boston who is just finishing up his architecture studies at MIT. He comes to New York City for a seminar held by the Dance Avant-Garde.
That seminar moved into the Judson Church and became the Judson Group, which was a bunch of really profoundly experimental people that was just abandoning all the things that we knew and held sacred about modern dance.
It was kind of taking all the hyperbole out of performance. The gorgeous, made-up, ribcage-out dancer, the noble dancer. We demolished the noble dancer. We just went back to pedestrian people.
The Judson Group is a loose collective, and while Solomon's is not affiliated for long, his dances reflect many of the same ideas. He explores how dance operates in public spaces and sets his choreography in plazas and parks.
Motion. Game. City motion, space game.
I made dances that were about dancing. Of course, this had absolutely nothing to do with what black dancers were doing in New York at that time. Because I was this white kid from Boston, you know. I mean, I grew up in an Irish Catholic neighborhood, and there were hardly any colored folks around me. So I had never learned about black culture or how to be colored. And so that was a big revelation to me when I came to New York. The aesthetic that I developed for myself came from these ideas.
That whole realm of experimentation is very important to the field because it opened doors. It told us that we...
And at the same time, have your dearest companion be such a person. Did I dare talk about that aspect of my heart on stage?
In 1983, Jones is one of the participants in a four-day series of concerts and symposiums hosted by the Brooklyn Academy of Music. Called Dance Black America, it is intended to take stock of the state of the art. Representatives from all corners of the black dance world are there. Amid conceptual discussions about diversity and identity, a young troupe from upstate New York seizes attention with its direct, visceral approach.
And on program A was Alvin Ailey, Dance Theater Harlem, Elio Pomare, and this little company from Rochester, New York, Bucket Dance Theater. It was so exciting for that many people coming from around the country and the world to see my company up there with the big guns. And Alvin Ailey, God bless his heart, said to me afterwards, "Garth Fagan, you took the show. Come here and give me some sugar." And it was so reassuring and such a welcome into the field.
It was a landmark event. It was the who's who in dance of black choreographers, teachers, students, etc. The New Moderns was represented particularly by Bill T. Jones. And in a panel called What is Black Dance, he made the provocative statement that he was an artist first who just happened to be black.
I always felt that a black dancer was a person, black dance was dance made by a person who is black, no matter what the choice of the form. It does not necessarily have to deal with the historical, socio-political condition of blacks in this culture. It can be anything it wants to be.
Jones's declaration sets off a controversy that rages through the panel discussions. Meanwhile, a diverse group of choreographers is presenting its work on the festival stages. Among them, Blondell Cummings. Taken as a whole, these artists obliterate any narrowly defined notion of what black dance can be.
Blondell's Chicken Soup and what she does with that is just one terrific example for me of a growing acceptance of people who have pushed the envelope, people who do go beyond the expected. They've managed to insist on their right to put on stage the experience that they've had, the way in which they want to express that without allowing anyone to fence them in. Frankly, when you look at them all together and you scan the field, you really can't say that black dance is any one particular thing. Let's push it one step
further. As their companies grow through the 1980s, Jones, Garth Fagan, and Jawale Zahler rely upon their dancers as a creative resource in realizing their vision.
I've kept my dancers so long because I take care of them, I challenge them, and I nurture them. They're family, real family. Without my dancers, there's no choreography. Choreography stays up here.
Working with the choreographer is like being in the relationship. And Bill demands of his dancers personally and spiritually. He says, I want to know who you are. I want you to talk to me, speak to me, tell me about, you know, what makes you tick. Don't just do what makes me tick.
In urban bush women, the boundary between choreographer and dancers is blurred. The group is highly collaborative, and Zahler's dances develop in workshops and evolve over time. Her dance, Shelter, grows out of an encounter with a homeless woman.
Last winter, I was working this tent job on the exclusive Upper East Side of New York City that lasted several months. Every day, on my way to and from work, I walked past a black woman who, in spite of sub-zero ice and snow, was living on the street.
One of the things that struck me about New York was seeing all of the homeless people in the early 80s. Those are people I know, and those are people I'm around, and I'm interested in them, and I'm interested in seeing how I can give voice to that individual through my imagination, through something I create on the stage. How can I find the dimension? How can I find the power in this character, in this person, and express that through my work?
Garth Fagan and his company remain in Rochester, New York. Being outside of New York City provides a calmer and less expensive place to live and create. But Fagan is still inspired by the city, which becomes the theme of a new evening-length work. Taking on the role of an African storyteller, or griot, he choreographs Griot New York.
At the time, everybody was down on New York. And I just wanted to celebrate the city with all its complexity, with all the complexity that is New York City.
Like Ailey, Fagan's work is both exuberant and accessible, leading to critical and popular success. His music-driven choreography will later reach even wider audiences when he collaborates on the Broadway hit, The Lion King.
Garth has this ability to pull out this marvelous rhythmic quality that gives you the feeling that you're not just listening to music, but you're watching it on stage. The dancer almost loses themselves in the music, and that's something very special.
Griot New York is a celebration, but it also addresses the plague which is profoundly altering the dance landscape. Thank you.
The whole AIDS epidemic has been so devastating to our field. In Griot, New York, I had this whole section about AIDS with the dancers moving downstage across the proscenium, helping each other. Every time I look back on the past and I think of all the wonderful people who are not here because of a moment of pleasure, love or lust, whatever, it's so frightening.
Throughout the 1980s, AIDS casts a long shadow across the dance world. Few companies are without at least one casualty. Others are even less fortunate. Among the dance community's losses are Rudolf Nureyev, Louis Falco, Ulysses Dove, and in 1989, Alvin Ailey himself.
I'm not in the at-risk group for AIDS, personally, but I have these magnificent dancers who work before me. And I've been in a situation where someone in fear of transferring from positive to AIDS won't stop and sit down, just keeps plowing away at the material that I've given them to work with. And I know he's dancing against death, and he won't sit down.
For Bill T. Jones, the epidemic is an inescapable issue in his life as well as his art. His longtime collaborator and lover, Arnie Zane, contracts the disease, and he dies in 1988. Jones himself is diagnosed as HIV positive. The following year, Damian Acquavella, a vibrant dancer in the company, also falls ill. Acquavella, affectionately dubbed D-Man by Jones, becomes the inspiration for D-Man in the Waters. The dance grows out of a dream in which Jones envisions a vast body of water filled with friends. Some swim peacefully, some have drowned, some are struggling against the current, and others are being saved.
It was made at a time when many, many people that I loved were growing sick and dying. D-Man is not a piece about AIDS. It's about loss and triumphing over loss. It's about life throwing down the gauntlet and you rising to the occasion.
D-Man is a true ensemble piece, calling upon the dancers to support each other, both physically and emotionally.
When you're in a position on stage of that kind of trust, where you have to catch someone or be caught, it's a blind faith. It's a blind faith that when I jump, this person is going to be there for me, and they're going to catch me, and it's going to be fine, and I'm not going to fall. I mean, everybody would love to live that way and just say, you know, have faith in life, and life is beautiful, and if I fall, I will be caught somehow. On stage is the only place that I've found that kind of freedom.
There's a gesture wherein one dancer is over and the other one's holding his back. I call it vomiting on Fifth Avenue. Arnie had been in chemotherapy, and he came out, and on Fifth Avenue, surprise to us both, he just began to retch. Something was redeemed by being able to take that very painful, humiliating moment, sorrowful moment, and inject it into this lyrical, energetic universe.
Thank you.
exhilarating, but it's exhausting. Reaching that point of exhaustion is what truly gives you the feeling of survival, because that's what the piece ultimately is about. It's about survival. And it's a piece, and it does end, and you do take your bow, and you go home, and you take a shower, and you forget about it. But for that moment, towards the end of the piece, when you're really exhausted, you're fighting to survive. And that's an incredible thing that Bill has been able to access, a true life thing in a make-believe world. It's a really amazing experience.
Since the very beginnings of modern dance, choreographers have incorporated social dancing into their concert work. They cull their material from clubs, city streets, wherever people move. In the Bronx in the late 1970s, DJs lay the groundwork for the creation of a new dance style. They begin queuing up the instrumental break sections of disco songs, repeating them to generate whole new tracks. Dancers fashion their own high-energy moves to this music, and the dance is soon known as breakdance.
Breakdance made a strong contribution to American dance. Every other dancer in every country said, "Oh, shit, look at what those people are doing."
Hip-hop, as this urban phenomenon is soon called, catches fire. As it comes to define pop culture, the new steps infiltrate the vocabulary of modern dance. But while hip-hop dance looks fresh, it is just one more example of how black dance evolves by borrowing from its own traditions.
Hip-hop has always been just an extension of traditional African dance and culture. We dance in a circle, which is the African circle. There's call and response that the MCs yell out. The audience responds, or the people who are sharing, they respond, or the dancers respond to the DJ's beats that he puts out and the music that he puts out. And so I believe that, you know, Africa has always been a part of hip-hop culture.
Choreographers coming onto the scene today, like their predecessors, draw freely from the vernacular. For Ron Brown, the blending of varied dance styles into a cohesive aesthetic places him squarely in the tradition of Catherine Dunham, Tally Beatty, and Alvin Ailey.
When people see the work and they see this urban attitude of this boy from Brooklyn, and they see the West African dance mixed with Western modern dance and capoeira, they go hip-hop. Which is cool, because eventually, hopefully, they get to the conversation of where does the contemporary come from, so that we can connect to the tradition.
He's a reflection of the power and grace and elegance that has developed since the inception of Africans in modern dance on the stage, from the 30s on. Had all the flippancy of, you know, hip-hop and the kind of get-out-of-my-way attitude at the same time that resonates with this African presence, which is this rhythmic insinuation.
Brown frequents gay dance clubs in the early 90s, and the dancing there becomes one more component in his choreography.
Going to the club to dance is a release, which is about letting your soul be free. You leave the world behind in a way, and you get lifted up by the music, by the other folks dancing. And it's that sense that I want to bring to the stage.
In 1998, Brown teams up with the veteran choreographer Donald McHale to work on a new ballet for the Dayton Contemporary Dance Company. McHale brings the experience born of half a century making dances. Together, they forge an unusual collaboration which bridges the generations.
I had this concept going into it that it would feel like kind of tag team choreography, and that's pretty much how it has played out.
Boom. Bob, don't transfer the weight onto that right foot.
I think the differences are what are beautiful. I mean, the fact if you're going to be homogenized, there is nothing. I think the fact that we are different is wonderful, and I celebrate our differences.
In Children of the Passage, dancers undergo a journey to self-awareness, discovering the essence of their past. The work is an affirmation of the African-American spirit.
It very much has to do with the fact that when we connect with our roots, with our past, we have something rich to draw on, rather than getting involved only with what is passing. We have to have some things that sustain us, and then we can go brightly into the future.
In creating their work, the two choreographers pull from the full repertoire of dance styles, including the rumba.
Watching an idea come into fruition feels a little bit like what I imagine it feels like to watch, to give birth and watch a child grow up. You have to sit back and watch. You know, you have to let it go. And so it's not until the premiere date and maybe some time after that when you realize, you know, that's that idea. That's that dream we had.
Throughout Children of the Passage, the sweep and artistry of African-American choreography can be seen. It's a heritage whose roots lie in the ring shout, one of the first dances slaves created in the New World. It's a tradition transferred to the stage by the likes of Edna Guy, Catherine Dunham, and Alvin Ailey. And this legacy is still defining itself today.
I feel humbled to be a part of the tradition of dance. I can't believe that I'm somehow connected to Alvin Ailey. And though my voice may be new, it has a very strong connection to what has come before me.
I look back on some of the people who, I mean, their work was so powerful, but yet what they had to go up against in order to get their work done, that it's made it so much easier for me. So to being part of a generation of artists who maybe we open doors through some kind of way of, by saying African-American dance can be absolutely anything.
I am making a path for people who come after me, and I was on a path that people made before me. And if I find my own route, then somebody's gonna follow after that, and they'll go off. So it's like a tree with a trunk and branches and twigs, and we're all part of this family tree, which we call modern dance.
To find out more, visit PBS.org or America Online keyword PBS.
Find the captain and I'll land in jail. Nobody around to go my bail. Darling, darling, darling. Now if I'd have had my weight in line. Darling, darling. I said if I'd have had my weight in line. Stone blind,
darling, I'm going,
darling,
darling.
Now if I'd have known my captain was blind,
darling, darling, darling.
Said if I'd have known my captain was blind, darling, darling. If I'd have known my captain was blind, I wouldn't have gone to work till half past nine,
darling, I'm going, darling.